Hey, Dads. You know, it's really good to see you. I know you may not hear this a lot, but we love you. And we hope you understand how important and how special it is that you're here. You know, there's probably 100 things you could be doing today, but you're here with us. And it means a lot. You don't have an easy job. Parenting comes with incredible challenges. And sometimes it's hard to know if you're doing it right. But you should know that being here right now, it's an important part. In the Old Testament, God gave this command: love the Lord your God with all of your heart, and with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. These words that I command you today should be on your heart. You should teach them diligently to your children. You should talk of them when you sit in your house or when you're walking down the street. Talk of them from the time you get up in the morning to when you fall asleep at night. So, what does it mean to be a good father? It means loving God with all of your heart, soul, and mind, and teaching your kids to do the same. And what an amazing example it is that you're here in the house of God, in the presence of other believers, seeking more of Jesus and worshiping unashamed. The young men and women here see you. The kids are watching, and as they grow, they'll remember and do the same. So thank you, Dads. Thank you for your presence and example. We pray that God will bless you today, renew your spirit, and draw you closer to Him, so you can continue to be a shining influence to all those around you. Happy Father's Day.
Well, good morning, and happy Father's Day to all the dads. We are so honored by your presence today, and we want to recognize the important role that you play. If you are a dad, because us dads, we don't like to stand up, right? We don't like to do that kind of thing. Stay seated, and let's show our appreciation for our dads here today. We do thank you for all that you do in raising your kids and teaching them about the Lord and all of those things. And we'll hear more about that in just a little bit. Dads, before you leave today, make sure to grab a coupon for a Shot of Grace drink, either a Italian soda or a espresso drink. You can grab those at the connection booth or just go straight down to Shot of Grace Cafe after the service. It's down in our fellowship hall, and you can enjoy a drink today on the church just to say thank you for being here and for being a dad. And we thank you for this opportunity to honor you. We have some things going on today that we want to let you know about. If you go back to our connections booth, if you are a new guest here, we have a gift to give you as well as a packet of information about our church. Also, if you are a regular attender or member, make sure to check in. You can do that on the Church Center app or use the connection card in the chair in front of you. Just jot your name down. You can put those in the donation boxes on your way out today. If you are newer to Grace and have never given us your information before, if you could fill out one of those connection cards, either the paper ones or there's a digital one at the connections booth, just give us as much information as you are comfortable sharing with us. We would really appreciate that. And also, we want to let you know there'll be a telephone number on the screen, and you can use that number to text in questions anonymously. And then on Thursdays, we post our weekend debrief podcast where Pastor Wes and myself talk about different things going on in our church and culture and community. But we also spend some time each week answering your questions that come in. So make sure to text those questions in, and we love to answer those each and every week. We've got a lot going on for our church family, so here is your Grace News for the week. Hey, don't forget, if you are looking for some coffee or a shot of espresso or Italian soda, our Shot of Grace Cafe has moved down to its permanent home in the Fellowship Hall. So between services, it'll be open. You can go down there, or if you just want drip coffee, it will be in our church library area right across from the ladies' restroom. And so either way, grab a cup of coffee, enjoy a conversation with someone. Enjoy.
Well, today is our third week of really focusing in on building believers, building community. And if you haven't already had a chance to grab one of the prayer journals, I would encourage you to do that. We still have another 5 weeks of study and really seeking the Lord's direction for our own personal lives and how the Lord would direct you to be a part of this next phase in our building project. With that, if you have not also, if you've not grabbed one of the commitment cards, I would encourage you to do so. And then spend some time over the next 5 weeks praying and seeking how the Lord would have you financially partner with the church as we look towards building into this next phase. This is above and beyond your normal giving, so please spend time in praying and fasting and seeking the Lord and how He would have you partner. So grab one of the connection cards, grab one of the prayer journals, and we look forward to seeing how God will work during this time.
Thanks again for joining us this Sunday. We are so glad that you were here with us. If you want to give to the ministries of Grace Church, make sure to use the giving envelopes and the seat backs. You can put them in the donation boxes on your way out. If you are a guest with us today, though, don't feel like you have to give. We're just glad that you joined us. Also, don't forget to download our Church Center app if you haven't already. Through that app, you can register for events and our services. You can also get to our streaming page for the live stream. You can see groups. You can give through the app. Everything with regards to our church now is being channeled through that app, so make sure to download it. Thanks again for being here. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
Well, this morning I want to start off. We think about so often we can come into this place, and again, we have so many things that are going on in our lives, whether good or bad. And it's a time to refocus, to set our eyes on Jesus, and just to take a breath, fresh air, right? And just be in God's presence and get ready for the rest of our week. And so this morning, I wanted to start off with just reading out of Psalm 23 before we sing this song that is right out of this psalm. So I want to invite you just to do something a little bit different. Just close your eyes, and I want you just to listen to God's word this morning as it speaks to us. Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." So I want to invite us to, let's stand together as we sing out that truth that God never lets go of us through the calm, through the storm, through every high, through every low, that God never lets go of.
Until that day comes, we'll live to know you here. The lowest place.
We thank you so much, Lord, that when we are in the lowest place, God, we can still worship you. We can choose to praise you. Lord, when the sun is shining, we praise you. When the storms are coming in our life, we still praise you. You are a good God, and we thank you for just the joy of the Lord that comes, not from our circumstances or the things in this life, but our joy comes from our relationship with you, that, Lord, that we have that inner peace because we have a right relationship with you through Jesus dying on the cross. And we believe that. We believe, Jesus, you died for our sin. We make you our Lord and Savior. We are saved. We're a new creation. And so we praise you for that today. We thank you, Lord, for your resurrection, that you defeated sin and death, that we can live a victorious life in freedom. And so we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, we are excited today. We have a family wanting to dedicate their child to the Lord. And so I'd like to invite up Rachel and Crosby Fuller and Henry. And as they come, here at Grace, we value children. Children have been entrusted to our care as parents, but also as a church. And as we think about that, children are the future, right? They are going to be the future in a lot of different areas. They are future church members, future evangelists, future pastors, future missionaries, future leaders, future business owners, future creatives. But not only are they our future, they are a part of our church in the present. And so we want to make sure we are doing the best job we can as a church to raise kids to know the Lord and follow the Lord. Scripture shows us how important children are to the Lord, especially Jesus. Jesus modeled this in his ministry. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 1, it says, at that time the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." And then Matthew 19, just a chapter later in verse 13, it says, "Then children were brought to Jesus that he might lay his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked the people. But Jesus said, 'Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them.'" Do not hinder them. For such to such belong the kingdom of heaven. And he laid his hands on them and went away. So we have been given the responsibility to like Jesus, prioritize ministry to children, like Henry. And for parents, we have a huge responsibility in that. We see in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. And that's a high calling. It's a challenge. And I know as a parent, it can be intimidating. I'm sure you guys feel intimidated by that. And so I would commend to you Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 when it comes to raising Henry. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. And this is what the Fullers desire to do. Trust in the Lord with all their heart and trust in the means by which God has given us encouragement and strength and help, and that is his church. We are to be involved together with the Fullers in raising Henry. They have a responsibility, and we as a church do as well. So I'm going to ask you a few questions, and if you agree to these things after each one, then say we do, and then I'm going to challenge our church family, and we will make a commitment to you as well. So Rachel and Crosby, in the presence of God, your friends and family, and this church body, do you commit to teach Henry the truth of the gospel and model for him the grace of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Do you commit to do your best to lead Henry to know Jesus and by God's grace have a personal relationship with Jesus? Do you commit to pray daily for Henry? He needs a lot of prayer. No. And do you entrust Henry to God's care and offer him to the Lord for his service and ministry? Awesome. And now, church family, do you, friends, family, and members of Grace Church, commit before God to devote your time, skills, and resources to help the Fullers raise Henry to know the good news of Jesus' death and resurrection? And do you commit to pray regularly that by God's grace, Henry would come to a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If so, answer, we do. All right, we're going to pray for this family. Come on up here as we pray for you guys and for Henry. Can I hold him? Can I hold you? No? Okay. All right. That's fine. Let's pray for the Fullers and for Henry. God, we thank you so much for Henry, for this this life, this young man who is so full of joy and energy. And Lord, we thank you for the gift of life, for the gift of Henry that you have given to Crosby and to Rachel. Lord, we pray that at a very young age that Henry would come to not just know of you, but have a personal relationship with you, that he would love you, that he would commit to follow you, that his life would be devoted to serving you in any way that you lead. And Rachel and Crosby have also asked that he would be known for his joy. Joy that only could come from you, and that as people see Henry and the joyful life that he leads, that they would be drawn to you. They would see that his joy comes from you and you alone. I also pray for Crosby as a father, that he would lead Henry in knowing what it means to be a godly man, a godly father. Lord, that you would give Rachel the ability to be the mom that Henry needs at every stage, that she would know what he needs and be able to respond to those needs. But that in all things, that both of them would always point back to you, your goodness, your grace, your gospel, the hope that we can have in you. And Lord, that you would bless this family. And Lord, we thank you so much for them. We pray that this church family would surround them with love, support, and encouragement, and everything they need to have the strength and the ability to lead their family well. We thank you and praise you for them, and we pray this in the name of Jesus. And all of God's people said,
amen. Amen.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, we're proud of you. Henry, good job, man. High five? No, okay. You guys can have a seat. Let's roll the video.
Hi, my name is Corey Miller. I think one thing missing out on not having a building is having our own space as a youth group just dedicated to us and having like our own surrounding compared to being in the church where just everybody kind of uses it compared to, like I said, not having like our own space to ourselves.
Hi, I'm Cassie Busher. I was part of the focus group for the building project for the new youth center. I think that it would be really helpful because We tend to break things in the sanctuary, and we just need a place to call our own and to personalize, I guess, and yeah, make it ours.
The reason why I think we need a youth house and what are the benefits of having a youth house is it's just going to be a lot bigger space.
There's not really places to go separately, like in our life groups. And that's hard because we need to be able to talk to our leaders and peers, not in front of everybody.
And I also think for other events as well that it'll be used for is also really amazing.
I'm really excited just to see how it turns out and how God uses it to bring new people. And I'm excited to just make it ours and decorate it how we want it.
I think bringing friends and other visitors to the old youth house would have been a little awkward, as it's all cramped and it's an old house, and compared to having a new youth building where it's open and everybody is kind of like in their own area, and it's a lot neater than the old one, and they don't feel like they're in a weird old house.
I guess it's just, I feel like we always get moved around. Like if we were to bring a friend now, we don't know where we're gonna be for youth group or on, you know, whenever. And I feel like if we have a set spot, it'd be more comfortable for them to know exactly where they're going and like kind of get to know the area better instead of just moving around from the sanctuary to the fellowship hall or wherever we're supposed to be. I'm excited for the like lounge area where we're gonna play games and have a foosball table and a carpet ball and the little dining area outside of the kitchen. I think that'll just be a good fit for us.
How the youth ministry has helped me become closer to God is just being closer with other Christians, both my age, younger, also older, and then also having some really amazing youth leaders that have also helped guide me from all the way from middle school and sixth grade all the way up till now, have helped me feel like grow closer to God.
I've gotten to know a lot of the students and leaders that are part of it and build really good relationships with them, and I know that I can come to them with all my problems and they'll help me and there's no judgment. Yeah.
No matter what my hair looks like, our youth group still accepts me.
Thank you. Speaking of breaking things, that does happen from time to time. So that was just some highlights of our year in youth group this last year. We had a lot of fun and just saw God do amazing things in the lives of our students and just really blessed. You saw in some of those pictures our youth leaders leading certain things and some guest teachers who were able to come as well, and just really blessed to be able to do ministry alongside such great people, and had to get that clock video in as a highlight. That's for sure a highlight of the last year, and it still works, so you can see it. Happy Father's Day, by the way, to all the dads out there. Just reflecting on this last year of youth group, and it just gets me thinking, and I think this happens every year for me. Why do we do it? Why do we have a youth ministry here? Why do we do what we do? Why do we make this such a priority here at Grace? Why are we stepping into the next phase of our building program, addressing our youth facility first? Why do we dedicate so much time and energy to our youth ministry? On one level, the answer is really simple, because we love our kids. We love our students. We want to see them discipled and raised up as followers of Jesus. But how should we think about how that happens? How should we think about the next generation being discipled and raised up? When I think about our youth ministry, I do feel it is very important, and I don't want that to go under the radar this morning, but when we look to the Bible, what we see most of the time is that the primary responsibility of discipling the next generation and raising them up, the primary responsibility is not given to a youth ministry. It's given to parents, and it's given to the wider church community. So that's what I want to kind of talk about today, and definitely get into the importance of our youth ministry, because it is important, and we'll get into that. But what we're going to see today for our big idea is that as the people of God, we are called to faithfully raise the next generation through setting an example of love and through the teaching of God's word. And so would you grab a Bible, or you can follow along on the screen this morning. We're going to be in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. The video we played earlier for Father's Day is my whole sermon. So maybe we could just roll that again. Oh, just kidding. But turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6, and in honor of God's word, would you please stand as we read this together? Chapter 6, verse 4. Listen, Israel. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These words that I am giving you today are to be in your heart. Repeat them to your children. Talk about them when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Bind them as a sign on your hand and let them be a symbol on your forehead. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your city gates. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are good and you are our God. You are the God that we serve. You are the God that we give our allegiance to. We worship you. We praise you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you that you've given us your church, that we can come together today and hear from your word. God, would you speak to us, give us wisdom, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can have a seat. These words out of Deuteronomy chapter 6 and really all of Deuteronomy were spoken by Moses. And it's interesting thinking about the context of Deuteronomy 6 and really all of Deuteronomy. These words were spoken to the next generation of Israelites. So at this point in Israel's history, they had been freed from slavery in Egypt. They had walked through the Red Sea on dry ground. They had witnessed God giving the law on Mount Sinai. And then they had wandered in the desert for decades. All of this happened under the leadership of Moses. Moses got to see that first generation come out of Egypt, and he got to lead them. But Moses is old, he knows his time is almost up, and he realizes it's been 40 years we've been wandering in the wilderness. There's another generation now, another generation that has been born and raised, and they need to know the law of God. They need to know God's word. And so that's what all of Deuteronomy is a retelling of the law for God's people so that the next generation can know it as well. Moses spoke these verses to remind God's people of who their God is and how they are to respond to him. Verses 4 and 5 of Deuteronomy 6 really lay out what is most important for God's people. God's people are to love the Lord their God with everything. In Jewish culture, these verses are known as the Shema. It's a prayer, and it's given significant importance, really among the whole Old Testament text. It's given a significant amount of importance. In ancient Judaism, and still in some cases today, these were the very first verses that Jewish children would memorize. This prayer was recited every morning and every night when they woke up and when they went to bed. And Jesus himself declared these verses as the most important commandment. In Mark chapter 12, when he was asked what's the most important commandment, Jesus answered, "The most important is, listen, Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other command greater than these." So not only were these verses, and not only was this prayer significant for the ancient Israelites, this prayer holds a lot of weight for us today as Christians. And as we think about raising up the next generation, we'll see that it is so important that we start here with love the Lord your God with everything. Verse 4 says, "The Lord our God, the Lord is one." The Lord, or you'll notice in your Bibles, it's in all caps. That is to let us know that this is the personal name of God, Yahweh, the name that he revealed himself as to his people. The Lord, the one true creator God, it says he is our God, the Lord our God. And what I want to point out first today is that the God that we know and serve is the God that our kids need to know and serve. The Lord is our God. He is who we serve. He is who we look to as our authority. He is the one who provides for us. He is the one who made us and everything around us. He is the one we worship. The Lord is our God. Remember, Moses is addressing the entire nation of Israel with the next generation present. And so as he gives this address, he refers to God as our God. He's making it clear that both the older and younger generations are included in that our God. He is our God. The older and the younger generations, everybody makes up the people of God. He's saying here that God's promises to the older generation are also God's promises to the younger generation. They are God's chosen people as well. Even if they weren't among that original group at Mount Sinai, they are God's people. And that's something for us to think about as we consider the up-and-coming generations in our church family. God's promises to them are his promises to us are his promises to them. They are just as much God's people as we are. Next thing we read in this verse is the Lord is one. Not only is he our God, he is also one. To say that God is one carries with it this idea that among all of the other gods that permeated the culture surrounding the Israelites, all the other gods, the lowercase g gods, the Lord, Yahweh, he is one. He is the one true God. That's why some translations, depending on which translation you're reading, some of it will read this as the Lord our God, the Lord alone. The Lord alone is our God. But to say that God is one also carries with it this idea that God is unchanging in his nature. He is one in the sense that he is consistent, he is faithful, he is true, he is one, he is unchanging. This God who is consistent and unchanging is who we are to serve. We serve him alone. God is to be the one God that we worship. He is who we give our allegiance and affection to. He is who our children need to give their allegiance and affection to. The God we know and serve is the God that our kids need to know and serve. So what does it look like to give God our allegiance and affection? How is our worship to him expressed? Well, we read in the very next verse, verse 5, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. Moses continues his address to the next generation, and he says that we give God our allegiance and affection by loving him. We are to love the Lord our God with everything. And this goes for everyone, for young and old. The older generation and younger generation are to love God with everything. Which brings us to our next point. We, along with our kids, are called to love God with everything. And so what does it mean to love God? We read here we are to love him with our heart and soul and strength. And so let's just talk about each of these really briefly, heart, soul, and strength. The Hebrew language and our English language are very different from one another. And so as we think about loving God with our heart and soul and strength, we need to be sure that we understand what the original language was communicating and be careful that we don't impose some of our own cultural understandings on these words. And so our heart. We are to love God with our heart. In our culture, generally speaking, the heart is a symbol for our feelings and emotions. In the Bible, the heart is a symbol for emotions, but it's a lot more than that, too. The heart also is a symbol for our thoughts. It's interesting, the biblical authors didn't really have a concept of the brain. When the way you think, according to this culture, is you think with your heart. So it's a symbol for your thoughts. It's also a symbol for the choices you make or the intentions that you have, the decisions you make. The Bible, the heart, shapes our character and our choices and our decisions. And so to love God with our heart is to love him in the way that we think and in the choices that we make. It's not only about emotion, it's also about action. Our soul, we're also to love God with our soul. When we think of our soul, we typically think of the spiritual, non-material side of ourselves. But in the Bible, the word soul is used not only to describe the spiritual side of a person, but to describe a whole, entire, living person, including the physical. I found it helpful to hear from Bible Project on this. Bible Project is a nonprofit who makes animated videos helping explain different books of the Bibles and of the Bible, singular, and different themes in the Bible, and also word studies, which they did for this prayer, the Shema. They did a word study kind of breaking down each of these words. And so what they have to say about the soul is this: to love God with all of your soul means to devote your whole physical existence to your Creator, the one who granted us these amazing bodies in the first place. It's about offering your entire being with all of its capabilities and limitations in the effort to love God and to love your neighbor as yourself. So to love God with our soul, it's about offering all of ourselves, our entire being. Finally, to love God with our strength isn't so much to love him with our physical strength, but to love him with every opportunity that we have. In every possible way, we love God in every situation that we find ourselves in. To love God with all of our heart and soul and strength, just to summarize, it's to love God with everything and in everything and in every possible situation every single day. If you're a Christian, if you have placed your faith and trust in Jesus, you have been brought into God's family, and you are called to love him with all of your heart and soul and strength. And isn't this what Jesus has done for us? He loved us with everything in order for us to be adopted into the family of God. He gave his very life for us. And whoever believes in him, we read in John 3:16, will have eternal life. So we love God in light of how much he loves us. And this is what is most important according to Jesus, to love God and to love our neighbor as ourselves. We, along with our kids, are called to love God with everything. I want to continue through our passage and just reread verses 6 through 9 again. It says, "These words that I'm giving you today are to be in your heart. Repeat them to your children. Talk about them when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Bind them as a sign on your hand and let them be a symbol on your forehead. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your city gates." Moses continues his address to the people. He says, "These words I'm giving you today are to be in your heart." These words, not only the Shema, not only verses 4 and 5, but all of Deuteronomy, in other words, God's word as they had it at that time, God's word is to be in your heart. It's to be so ingrained in the lives of the people that it's in their heart. God's word plays a pivotal role in the day-to-day lives of his people. And if our heart is a symbol for our thoughts and our decisions and our choices, then for God's word to be in our heart is for it to be understood first and then lived out in obedience. We have a phrase in English for this, right? We'll say from the head to the heart. When we're learning something, oftentimes we say, yeah, we got the head knowledge, but it really needs to become heart knowledge. You've probably heard that phrase before. In English, we say from the head to the heart. But in Hebrew, all you have to say is in the heart, because it's where you're understanding it, and then it's where you're saying, I get it, I understand it, I'm going to live it out in obedience. We love God with everything as we hear from him and obey him. It reminds me of the words of Jesus. Jesus talked like this when he taught about what he commanded, what he taught in John 14. He said, "The one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. And the one who loves me will be loved by my Father. I also will love him and reveal myself to him." Jesus says, the one who has my commands, the one who hears them, hears me teach, understands it, and then keeps them, and then obeys, that's who loves me. When we understand God's word, we obey it, and we prove our love for him. As we continue reading, we see that when God's word plays this kind of role in our lives, it spills over into everything, including our family life. Which brings us to our third point. We are called to teach our kids about the God we love. We cannot be silent on God's word in our homes. I want to talk to the parents here just for a few minutes. Parents, we must teach our kids to love God. We read in verse 7 that we are to repeat God's word to our children. That sounds like kind of a simple phrase, and it is, but there's a lot of really interesting things about that word, repeat. Repeat God's word. And I love the way that ESV translates it. I think it helps me understand it a little better. You shall teach them diligently to your children. We are to teach God's word to our kids. And I love how these verses lay it out for us as verse 7 continues. It doesn't really make it all that complicated. We get the sense of, okay, as I'm living my daily life, as I'm doing my thing, I'm teaching God's word. It's rather simple, but it is something we need to take seriously and be consistent with. But it doesn't necessarily have to be complicated. I think about my dad growing up, so blessed by my dad and my mom, both Christians, so blessed to grow up in that kind of household. But I can remember when we'd go to bed, my younger brother and I shared a room, and so my dad would come to put us to bed, and before bed, he would always tell us a story from the Bible. And I don't remember my dad reading the story from the Bible so much. Sometimes he'd bring his Bible with him, but more what I remember is he would tell us a story from memory. When I realized later, that meant that he knew the story well enough to retell it without his Bible in front of him, which meant that God's word first played an important role in his life, so much so that he could talk about it and tell us the stories from memory. I also remember my dad memorizing scripture with us before bed. One of the ones I remember most is Romans 8, 38 and 39, that nothing could separate us from the love of God. But every night for a while there, we'd recite that together, we'd memorize it together. And this time of him telling a story and teaching, and it usually ended with some sort of intense wrestling match that I'm sure me and my brother initiated. And it would shake the whole house, and my mom would have to come break it up and, all right, it's time, seriously, guys, it's time to go to bed. And that, I felt like that was every night. My dad and my mom as well, they diligently taught me God's word. And I'm so grateful that they did. They left me a great example for how I can teach my kids God's word as they get older. And again, we read in Deuteronomy 6, 7, we don't get the sense this needs to be complicated. It says, when you sit in your house and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up, as life is being lived, God's word is being taught. God's word is not only to be taught from the pulpit on Sunday mornings, but also in homes every day as a part of ordinary life. I loved how Christopher Wright put this in his commentary on this verse. He said, the priests of Israel were indeed to teach the law, but not as something only they within the confines of the professional guild could understand. On the contrary, the law was to be the topic of ordinary conversation in ordinary homes and ordinary life from breakfast to bedtime. Parents, we are called to teach God's word to our kids, not occasionally, not every once in a while, but often. This is not just the job of their pastor or their youth pastor or their children's director. This is the job of parents as well. I want to talk in a second about how our pastors and ministry leaders can play a significant part in this. We are here to help. We're here to teach God's word as well. But we see clearly in our passage here today that a large responsibility is placed on parents to teach God's word to their kids. Verses 8 and 9 give more instruction on what to do with God's word. It says, bind them as a sign on your hand. Let them be a symbol on your forehead. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your city gates. These were verses that Israel took very literally. You may have seen pictures, or maybe you've been to Israel and you've seen this, the phylacteries on someone's head and hand, or the mezuzah on somebody's doorpost. These things they would tie to their foreheads and hand and put on their doorpost. There was God's word in those boxes, a symbolic way and a symbolic reminder. But I think the symbolism here is actually really powerful, that as you're putting the phylacteries on your head and hand, you're saying God's word plays such a pivotal role in my life that it influences my thoughts, it influences my actions. To put it on your doorpost is to say God's word plays such a pivotal role that it influences my household. And on your city gates, for ancient Israel, to say that we are a society about serving God. For us today in our culture, maybe we think about it more as God's word plays such a pivotal role in my life that it influences the way I interact in my society and in my culture. God's word is to be central to our lives. And imagine how impactful it is for our children to see God's word playing this kind of role. And how powerful it is for our kids to see God's word influencing us in these ways. I was so challenged by this next quote. It's from a guy named Michael McGarry. He's been in youth ministry for like 14 or 15 years, and he wrote this book called A Biblical Theology of Youth Ministry, and I was so challenged by this quote, and I hope it challenges the parents here. When parents' love for God is at the center of everything they do, their children will not only be instructed in the faith, but also given a model to follow. On the other hand, when the commands of God are rarely seen in the life of parents, children may hear them taught, but are learning them as abstract principles that are not lived out in the real world. This is why before we teach our kids to love God with everything, we first love God with everything. Parents, we lead the way in loving God. We not only teach our kids to love God, but we love Him first. I'm a new parent. I'm pretty new at this. My daughter is a year and a half old. Our son is on the way. So I'll be the first to admit I don't have a ton of experience with this yet. But I hope to love God with everything and live out His word. And I hope that my daughter and my son will see that and have an example to follow. And that's as much as I can do. All I can do is teach them God's word and set an example for them. Whether they decide to follow Jesus is not up to me. But I pray that God will be at work in their lives as they grow up and will draw them to himself. That part is out of my control. But I am called, and parents, we are called to lead the way for our kids and teach them and pray for God to do the rest. We are called to teach our kids about the God we love. Parents, does this sound overwhelming? It does to me, honestly. It's a big responsibility. But let me assure you, parents, that you are not in this alone. I've talked to our parents here for a while now, but I want to address everybody here now. Raising the next generation is not only on the parents. Yes, there is a lot of responsibility given for parents to disciple their kids, but that does not mean that parents are to do it alone. The Christian life in general is not meant to be lived alone, and neither are parents to raise their kids alone. Raising the next generation as followers of Jesus is to be a community effort. In fact, in the Old Testament culture, parents and families would have been raising their kids on the family compound, and they were surrounded by extended family and by the broader community. Because of this, all the generations were expected to play a part to raise up the younger generation to walk with the Lord. And it sounds a little bit like church to me. All of the generations that are represented here, in all of our different phases of life and our different gifts that we bring to the table, we are called to play a part in raising up the next generation. This is to be a church-wide effort. We saw an awesome example of this with the Fullers today and with Henry, that they committed, yeah, we want to dedicate Henry to the Lord. We want to raise him up and teach him. But we as a church also committed to that, didn't we? We all said we will do that. We want to help the Fullers in that effort. A couple months ago, my daughter, Adeline, along with four other families, we all stood up here and we dedicated our kids to the Lord. And we committed to teaching our kids and being models of the gospel for them. But then our church family also committed to helping us. And trust me, we need your help. We want your help. We need the help of our grace group, and we need the help of our church families, especially those that we've been connected with here. Raising the next generation together is also why we have youth ministry here at Grace. This finally gets us back to the first question I asked: why do we have youth ministry here in our church? Have you ever thought about that? Why do we have youth ministry in our churches today? Look in the Bible, you won't find a youth group in any of the early churches. There's no verse that explicitly commands youth ministry. The temple in Jerusalem didn't hire youth workers to lead games and songs and service projects and to teach Bible lessons. Instead, the wider community played a role in raising up the next generation. So why do we have youth ministry? Well, youth ministry is a way that we as a church family seek to live out the commands in Scripture to raise the next generation. Those commands that we need to raise the next generation and teach them about God and be examples of love for them, we want to take that seriously as a church. And so having youth ministry is an application of how we want to address that command and be faithful to that command. Our youth ministry may not be the primary way that the next generation is discipled, but we do want to play a part in that. Again, from Michael McGarry, I found this quote helpful. Biblical youth ministry is a modern application of the frequent commands to pass on the commands of God to the next generation. The Bible, and especially the Old Testament, emphasizes that parents are given the primary responsibility of evangelizing and discipling their children. Yes, parents are given the primary responsibility, but our youth ministry wants to play a part in discipling the next generation. We want to help parents in this mission. Parents, be encouraged that you are not in this alone. It's the responsibility of all of us, the local church, to partner together to raise up the next generation. Parents disciple their kids in the way of Jesus, and other families come alongside them and help, and they come alongside those families and help, and those maybe without kids, and or maybe their kids are grown and out of the house, they come alongside and help. It's really a beautiful thing, and what an amazing support system we have in the church. What an amazing way we can help and serve one another. As the people of God, we are called to faithfully raise the next generation through setting an example of love and through the teaching of God's word. So what are some practical steps we can take? I just want to list out a few things quickly here, and how can we put this into practice now? What steps can we take to invest in and teach the next generation? First, we love God first. We have to start here. When we love God and have a healthy relationship with him, that will pour into everything else, including how we lead our families and how we invest in the next generation. Love the Lord your God with everything, and then teach your children. Secondly, parents and teens attend church together. As mentioned earlier, there's no youth group mentioned in the early church. However, it's apparent that teens were present in the main body of believers when they met for worship. And that needs to be true today as well. When our teens graduate high school, youth group ends. Our youth need to understand the importance of being connected to a local body of believers. That understanding needs to start when they're still in middle school and high school. One more quote from Michael McGarry. This is kind of the tagline for his book, but I think it's so helpful. Youth ministry is for adolescents. The family is for life, but the church is for eternity. Youth ministry, by its very nature, is temporary for our kids. When they graduate high school, they're out of our youth ministry. The family is, hopefully, for life. Students always have their families, and hopefully always have their families pouring into them, discipling them, leading them. But the church is for eternity. The church is forever. The church is Jesus' plan to redeem the world back to himself. And our students need to have an understanding of that and be a part of this community. Children and youth connect and commit to specific ministries for their age group. None of this is to say that children's ministry and youth ministry is not important. It is so important. And in our children's and youth ministries, our kids find community with others their age at a similar life stage where they can be encouraged and learn in an environment that is catered to where they're at in life. Another amazing thing about this is in these groups, our kids find leaders who want to invest in their lives, leaders who love them and who want to disciple them, teachers who want to teach them. It's really an amazing thing. Fourth, youth group needs to be viewed as a connection point to our larger church family. Our kids are just as much a part of the people of God as we are. We need to see them that way. We need to treat them that way. And youth group is not church. It is not a replacement for gathering as the people of God on Sunday morning. Youth need to be present here with us. Fifth, youth need to view themselves as members of the people of God and as part of our church family. They have a part to play. Students here, teenagers, this one is for you. You need to understand this, that you are a part of this church family. And you have a crucial role to play here. So be committed here. Be invested here in your church. Sixth, parents, think of ways to have conversation around God's word as you live life with your kids. Let this be a natural and fun part of your days and weeks. And don't feel the pressure to come up with all the material by yourself. There are really awesome resources out there. And I know we as a pastoral team would love to help you get connected if you're interested and if you're needing some resources like that. And finally, lastly, if you are not yet a parent or if you have kids that are grown and out of the house, consider how you can play a part in investing in the next generation. Maybe it's being connected in relationship with other families, and as you have friendships with other parents, maybe you develop relationships with their kids and are able to speak into their lives. Maybe you're interested in serving in our children's or youth ministries here at Grace. I know for our youth, we're going to be looking for more leaders this next ministry year starting in the fall. If you're interested in serving in our youth ministry, I'd love to talk with you. Let me know. I know for Carissa, our children's director, I know she's looking for more leaders to serve in the fall as well. And so if you're interested in serving with the younger kids, reach out to Carissa. That would be an awesome way to invest in the next generation. But I can speak for our youth ministry, and I know our desire is to see the next generation follow Jesus. We're stepping into the next phase of our building program, and I just encourage you today that if you have not taken a pledge card home, grab one today, take it home, and pray and seek the Lord for how he might have you be involved in this project. Also, don't forget a devotional guide that will help guide your time in prayer as you seek the Lord for this project. A new building does not change our mission as a youth ministry, but it will provide what we need in order to accomplish what God has set before us. That is to play a part in raising the next generation to know and follow Jesus. As the people of God, we are called to faithfully raise the next generation through setting an example of love and through the teaching of God's word. We started our time today reading from the Shema, this ancient Jewish prayer out of Deuteronomy. Like I said before, this prayer was traditionally recited every morning and every night, every single day. I thought it would be appropriate that as the worship team comes up, that we could read this out loud together, that we could pray this prayer as a church. So would you follow along on the screen as we read this out loud together? Let's read. It says, "Listen, Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." Let's go from here in obedience, seeking to love God and teach the next generation to do the same. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are good. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for what you've done for us, that you have given your life, that we could know you and have a relationship with you, that you have brought us into your family. God, would you help us as a church be faithful to the next generation, that we might set an example for them and that we would faithfully teach them who you are and what you've done for them. God, I want to pray for the parents here that you would give them the grace that you've shown them, that they would have that same grace for their kids, that we would model the gospel well. God, I pray for our church as a whole that we would take this seriously, that we want to be faithful to our kids. God, we need your help in that. Help us to also help each other in that. God, we love you, and we come before you now in worship. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing this song, "Be Thou My Vision," that this would be the prayer of your heart, that personally and as a church, we would say, Jesus, we want to make you the center of everything that we are, the center of everything that we do.
Oh,
The center of everything we do. Jesus, that you would be just our focus, that with our kids or with our grandkids or with people that we interact with, that Lord, your word would be just coming out of our mouths. It wouldn't be our own wisdom, but it's your wisdom. We thank you again just for salvation that we have in you. God, that we have true joy in you. As we sing this last song, that this would just be that our prayer, that we would build our lives upon you. You are holy, you're set apart. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's sing that God is worthy of every song that we could ever sing, that he's worthy of all the praise that we could bring.
Holy, holy.
specifically the fathers this morning. I pray over the parents in here, Lord, that God, that they would follow you with their whole hearts, with their minds, their souls, that they would teach your word to their kids, that you give them the strength. Lord, that you would just be at work in their lives, that it would just be an overflow of their relationship with you, that it would just come out of them as they're going about their day, that they would bring things up about you. And so I just pray over specifically these parents this morning. And I just pray over us as a church, Lord, that we would teach the word of God, that we would not be ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation for those who believe. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being here today. Happy Father's Day. We hope you guys have an awesome rest of your day. We are a church that is all about worshiping God by making disciples. And just hopefully you're encouraged today. We think about making disciples of the next generation. So go from here, consider how you can do that. We love you guys. Have an awesome rest of your Sunday. You're dismissed.